is to give you a little idea of where we're living out here this winter. It's Cochise Canyon. We're north of Tucson, and it's surrounded by mostly public land. There's even a park, Tortolina Mountain Park, and there's a little bit of private land within this area. We have a 10-acre parcel. A lot of it includes this mountainside, which isn't overly useful for development, but for somebody like me that just wants to protect their view, it's spectacular to have these giant saguaros, multiple armed saguaros, which will show up here in the footage. But it takes a saguaro something like 60 to 100 years to get the first arm. So when you see these guys with arms galore, they're like, these are like the redwoods of the desert, so to speak. So they're pretty awesome. For somebody like me that's a photographer, I love having these rocks, these saguaros, and all this kind of stuff. So this is our fifth wheel. Get a little better view of it. We bought a little, storage unit, shipping container. So it's enabled us to have a few extra niceties that we can put in the shipping container and store, like a picnic table and a fire pit and barbecue. Some of this stuff we don't have when we're on the road with the RVs. That's been kind of nice. So kind of living a little nicer than we normally would, but as you can see here, this is the fifth wheel. One of the things, the first time I ever saw a fifth wheel was one of my parents' friends. And when I walked in and got a little tour of it, I loved the big window out the back. I thought that was awesome. And so ours has a window out the back. And so now whenever I go to a campground, if I could get a back-end sight on the back side, or anytime I can back in and get a great view, I try to do that. So here we positioned ours so it backs into the back. And it looks at this mountain, and I have my bird feeders and hummingbird feeders back here. So we're getting cardinals, we're getting quail, we're getting all kinds of stuff all day long, not to mention javelina and gray fox. So you'll see on the inside tour, our chairs are usually facing the back looking at that mountain, which is pretty, I mean, we could kill hours just sitting there looking at the stuff coming and going and watching the animals and stuff. So this kind of gives you a good overview. My plan is to make this a little bit of a photographer's destination where I could teach workshops and do different teaching things where people could come and do their own photography, that kind of thing. So, and I'll show you a couple of those things here in a moment, but that's the long-term plan here that we're working towards. So we've talked about even putting down some bricks, but right now we just got a Walmart piece of carpet down here. I hauled in a little sand just to keep things clean and keep thorns and scorpions out, and we're able to pick up a little fire pit and barbecue. What's nice about Arizona, especially this time of year, is the outdoor living, because it's we're having a little bit of a cold spell now, and yet I'm still out here in short sleeves. So, you know, we can cook, we can eat, we can sit out here and watch sunset. So it's, by being in such a nice climate, we've kind of doubled our RV space, so to speak, because we can spend so much time outdoors cooking and eating. And when it gets hotter out, when it gets real hot, we'll go back to Alaska. But when it gets hotter, it's nice to barbecue and not have the oven going inside and heating up the RV as well. So, I mean, a beautiful evening in Arizona when it's still warm enough to have shorts on and to be out here sitting around the barbecue looking at the stars or looking at sunset, that's just like way better than any TV show you'd probably ever find. It's just a great way to spend some time. A friend of ours gave us this little ATV, which has kind of come in handy, but we've gotten into we like to run and bike anyway, but we also started getting into CrossFit back in Seward. So I got some of these pads. They're stall mats. You get them for 30, 40 bucks at Tractor Supply Store. They give us a clean place to do weights. We got some weight benches and some weights and some kettlebells. We got a big wooden box so we can do jump ups on the box. So we can kind of do a full kind of CrossFit workout like we do back home. And I put in a pull-up bar you can see in the background there next to the saguaro. Had to dig those posts about 3 feet down. I think I probably got a better workout digging those posts out than I ever will on the pull-up bar. But it's kind of nice. I was telling Chris earlier, between our running shoes, our mountain bikes, and this kind of stuff, we can work out and stay shape and get all sorts of entertainment for basically free. I mean, we had a little bit of a fixed cost, but we don't have a gym membership, and yet we have like the best looking gym, you know, that I can imagine, outdoors like this and in the wet, you know, in the sunshine. So we try to make this as comfortable, and that was one thing that I found as we traveled, that sometimes it's hard to keep up on fitness, especially if you're in a kind of a city campground. A lot of them don't have little workout facilities like you find in hotels, and so I found it was difficult to stay in shape, so this was kind of important that we had kind of some little workout stuff. The guy that we purchased the land from was pretty handy as a contractor, actually. So we had septic here anyway, and water and power to the site. We ended up hiring him this summer to come in and put RV hookups. It's just like any campground, more or less. There's a septic. Got a little extra stuff over here, but basically a 4-inch, I think it is, pipe going into the ground, not unlike what you might find at a lot of campgrounds. And then a water spigot, and Arizona water is notoriously horrible, so I have a little softener, which keeps all the white particles developing. But then he also put in a 50-amp and a 30-amp and a 20-amp electric service. So we pull up here, kind of like our little private RV park. Plug in, hook up, just like we would at an RV park, And of course, we were able to have them put those in the perfect location so I don't have a bunch of sewer lines running and everything. It's worked out really, really nice. I hear some quail right now, but they might fly off. We have a number of hummingbird feeders around, and I feel like calling them woodpecker feeders because the woodpeckers are drinking as much as the hummingbirds ever do. I haven't put food out. Oh, I don't see it. My suet's even emptied. I haven't put anything else from this morning. Usually at lunchtime, I'll put some extra stuff out. So most of it's empty right now, but gosh, we get so many different birds through here. Animals that feed on the seed that's fallen on the ground, like javelinas and gray fox. But we get cardinals, we get quail, we get pyrexia, we get a lot of birds that are unique to this area. Right now, most of them kind of flew off when I walked back here because I'm not being quiet. But when we're inside our RV with kind of the mirrored glass, they can't see us. We can watch out. And so it's like we're invisible to them. And so you see all sorts of, I mean, right where I'm standing is where the gray fox will sometimes pick up little seeds off the ground. We're just a couple feet away from a fairly rare animal, just able to stare at him and look at every little nuance of his fur and his eyes. And one day we were eating lunch and a ring-tailed cat walked through here, which is extremely rare. They're nocturnal for one. Most people in Arizona will go a lifetime without ever seeing one. So being out here in the middle of nowhere like this certainly is exposing us to amazing wildlife that you wouldn't see in the city, which is what our goal was. So our plan is to put in some blinds, and I can show you where it's going to be, where we're going to have a little water feature. And I'm trying to build it in such a way that the animal's forced to come up a certain direction so that they're always facing the blind, they're facing the photographer, they're facing the best light, and they will attract birds. We'll have different bird seeders and different perches for the birds. So the photographer, you could come here. Let's say you've always wanted to get a picture of a cardinal and a quail and and a gray fox. You could come here and see all those things, hopefully just in 1 or 2 days, and get photos of all those things. And if you wanted to learn more about the stuff, you could hire me and I could teach you how to take photography and teach you about your camera and that kind of thing. So whether it's wildlife, whether it's night skies, whether it's landscapes or macro with the flowers and cactus, I'm hoping to be able to offer a bunch of different types of classes and seminars and just rent out this place for different photographers. And along those same lines, we have a little Airstream, and we're going to put in a little dry camping site as well where people could then stay in this little Airstream or just camp in their tents and come out here and hang out for the night and do some photography or just hang out and enjoy it. So that's kind of, we're hoping to turn this into a little bit of a winter business, and that's our plan right now. We've been working really hard the last couple of months trying to get it ready, and we got a few more months of work to do for sure. So this is a beautiful little campsite over here where the Airstream is. When you're at this little campsite for this Airstream, you can't see anything else around. And again, we put in a little fire pit. It's one of the smaller Airstreams. It's a sport. It's only about 20, 21 feet. And like most Airstreams, it doesn't have a slide out. But it's a cute little guy inside and comfortable for 1 or 2 people. But then we got a fire pit. We're going to put a barbecue here. And from here, again, you're just looking straight up at this mountain. There's a couple ravens flying by up here, but I mean, a lot of these plants are going to bloom in the spring. There should be beautiful wildflowers. These saguaros even get beautiful blooms in the spring. And so you got these big rocks. It's just a beautiful place just to kind of hang out and take in the Sonoran Desert and do photography at the same time. So this is going to be one aspect of our business, but the photography will be the bigger part of our business, which I'll show you here in a second. So this is a bit of a walk. I wanted to keep the actual blind separated from where we're staying and where the Airstream is. As you notice, when I walked outside, a lot of the birds will flush And so I didn't want our day-to-day activities scaring the wildlife away. There's a big rock up here, and around this area that we're approaching, I've done a lot of research on the types of plants that attract butterflies and hummingbirds, and we've gone to a local native, in Tucson there's a native plant nursery, and we've bought a number of plants that will attract just butterflies and hummingbirds, like the milkweeds and different hummingbird plants. But in a year or two, this area should be pretty lush and pretty active with both butterflies and hummingbirds. You can see the little one right here with the red on it. Here's an example of one of the swirls on our property. It takes, I don't know, 60 to 100 years to get the first arm, and this guy's got, I don't know, 10, 20 arms on it, just 30 feet high. It's just a spectacular saguaro. Just love having those things on the property. But, and this will eventually be a little bit of a trail. We're going to clear the rocks and make it easier for people to walk out this way. The other reason I put this blind way over here is because the mountain doesn't block the sun in the evening. So this area gets gorgeous evening light because the sun's setting real low in the horizon. We're over where we were, the mountain kind of blocks the sun in the evening and you get a big shadow, where here you get just gorgeous evening light. But I've been feeding the birds over here already, and I have a little solar pump so I can keep the water circulating so I don't get mosquitoes, and I also get a little sound because the sound of running water will also attract the birds. But if you look at this little water tank, so when people come here to photograph, they won't be photographing the front edge. The water is really just to attract the animals. And then the animals will tend to walk up this way. You get this beautiful background. And most people will be photographing from over here looking this way. And so I kind of controlled where the animal is, where the background is, and how they're facing as best I can. So I think I got the best of both worlds here. And I even have it set up on the solar system. This will all be controlled from within the photo blind itself, where you could turn on the water, you could turn it up and control the level, how hard it's going. Because that sound right there, just the water flowing, that attracts birds, that attracts wildlife. They hear that, especially in the desert where water is so critical. They'll hear that and they'll come from fairly far away. And it helps muffle the photographer, the sound of shutters and that type of thing as well. It kind of drowns that out. So it serves a couple purposes. And then ultimately, there's going to be a building right behind here. And this is where I've been digging. One of the things that photographers covet is being low with their subject, especially if it's wildlife. So you're shooting at the same level as, say, a gray fox or javelina, because it puts the background out of focus. It makes a more pleasing picture. And when it comes to birds, things like that, a lot of times you'll find photographers are laying on the ground to photograph their subject, so they're at the same level. But a lot of people don't want to lay on the ground to photograph animals at that same level. So what I've done is I've been digging, and as you can see here, Janine and I have had to move some pretty big rocks. In the desert, I was joking, if I get a shovel full here and it has grapefruit-sized rocks like this, this is like I'm happy to have a shovel like that, because so often it's something like that. It's not easy digging, but the reason I'm digging it down is so then people will be able to come into this little building. It's going to have a mirrored or one-way glass here, and you'll be able to sit down and be effectively at eye level with the wildlife straight across from you. So this way you don't have to lay in the grass you don't have to lay in the cactus and get all dirty. You can still be at ground level and yet be comfortable in a nice building. So this is where we're kind of aiming, is to have this little business going and kind of help support our whole RV lifestyle. So kind of a crash course on photography and everything else that might interest people, might not, but that's what we're doing here. Let me give you a quick tour of the inside. I gotta warn you, I did zero to make it look nice in the cleanup. So this is what you see, is how we live day to day. Apologizing in advance for how this place looks, but we even have our lunch set out. But this is a convenient little kitchen area. You know, it's funny, RVs have had the open floor plan for a long time, which has now become such a popular thing with homes. But if you come on in here, you could see two of our favorite aspects with this thing. One was this light out that's a standalone office, which, so this is Janine's office. She got the big screen, the printer. She can do everything she could do pretty much at home as long as we had Wi-Fi and a cell phone. So it's funny, people would call, we'd get magazines calling saying, hey, so how's the weather in Alaska? And it's like, well, you know what, we're not in Alaska right now, so we could totally keep up with business with this. Then my other favorite part of this fifth wheel was, and this is true for a lot of fifth wheels, is this big window out the back. It's mirrored so the birds, the wildlife, they can't see us when they're out there. We can just sit here and watch things coming and going. And in fact, it's so hard to see in and so mirrored that birds were flying into the window, so we put these ugly post-it notes on the window just to keep birds from striking the window. It's kind of unfortunate they're there, but it's better than having a bird hit a window. So I could just sit here for extended periods of time, reading and just looking out, watching things come and go. Like I mentioned earlier, we get gray fox through here. We had ring-tailed and javelina with the javelina babies. We had last spring, we had quail with quail babies that are about an inch tall. I mean, there's always something different to see out here, it seems like. And then I can show you real quick the bedroom. The one thing I liked about this when we were fifth wheel shopping, and now I know in 10 years, this is 10 years old now, a lot's changed. But when we were shopping, one of the keys was to have the slide out for the bed itself, which didn't seem like a big deal. But without the bed slide out, the bed ends up going this direction, and you lose this storage area, you lose this as well. So just having a little slide out for the bed allows you to have a dresser here and allows you then to have all this storage here, which when you're going for months at a time, especially like us, where you might be going from a cold climate to a warm climate, where you need shorts, where you might need a down jacket, having extra storage was really nice. And the other thing I liked about the fifth wheel was the big, we call it the basement. But you get this whole area pretty much underneath a big part of this bedroom is just one big open storage area. And with this unit, it's heated. That was another thing we liked about this is it was a heated underbelly so that we could camp because we wanted to be able to camp in the winter conditions and cold conditions without everything freezing. So that was another thing we paid extra for was with this model, it was a four-season or at least a three-season RV that could be used in below freezing temperatures. I will say the heater runs a lot when it's like that, but at least you have the flexibility. Totally comfortable for two people, yeah. The showers in the bedroom, some people might not like that. I found it to be no problem. This doesn't work very well. Like when we have friends visit us, the couch will make into a bed, but it's not, if you had kids, for example, this really wouldn't probably work nearly as well, but it's ideal for two people. I find it plenty roomy, plenty of storage, even for multiple month trips. You know, you could always have more space, but you know, I find that if you have more space, you end up just filling it. So the 30 foot to me was a good length. It's manageable, it's towable. You can get in and out of a lot of campgrounds that you might not be able to otherwise with a bigger unit. I found it to be a perfect length. Bathroom's plenty big enough. It ends up being kind of a combo bathroom bedroom. So you have the shower here and a sink here. Some of the things you get with the bigger units is like a separate bathroom that's enclosed. You know, this one, the toilet, is separated by a door and enclosed, which is appropriate. But the sink and the shower, I don't mind them here. We wondered about that at first, and it's worked out to be totally fine. And it's one of the things that you have to give up when you're only 30 feet is you have, you know, some of the compromises is a sink and a shower in your bedroom, which worked out fine for me. Like I said earlier, I don't think there's anything I'd do different. It's worked out fine. It's especially coming from a little camper. It seemed so roomy at first when we were in here. It's just like, oh my gosh, we could play frisbee in here, it seemed like.